Letter 28. My dear Father, like all my letters, the theme of this will be Jesus, whose claims to be the Messiah I unspeakably rejoice to hear you are beginning to regard with more favorable eyes. Now Jesus, whose power to work miracles you yourself, my dear Father, have confessed must be conferred by Jehovah alone, asserts distinctly and everywhere that he is Messiah, the Son of God, the Shiloh of Israel, of whom Moses and the prophets so eloquently wrote. Besides claiming for himself this high character, he was heard by both my Uncle Amos and myself in the synagogue at Bethany 2 days after he raised Lazarus from the dead, to read from Isaiah the words following and apply them to himself, which he had done before at Nazareth. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. The synagogue was thronged, so that people trod upon one another. All eyes were now intent, and all ears were ready to hear what he should speak. He then said unto them, This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Ye ask me, O scribes and men of Israel, to tell you plainly who I am, whether I am the Christ or no. What saith the prophet of Messiah when he shall come? Ye have just heard his words. If such works as he prophesieth do show forth themselves in me, know ye not who I am?
Here a voice cried out in the assembly,
Tell us plainly, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Highest?
At this direct inquiry, there was intense interest shown to hear the reply. Jesus seemed about to answer, when a man, who stood near the reading desk and whom was an unclean spirit, cried out with a shrieking voice of mingled terror and awe,
Let me alone, leave me as I am, thou Jesus of Nazareth. Art thou come hither to destroy me? I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God.
Jesus rebuked the devil which possessed the man and said, in the voice of a master commanding a bondslave,
Hold thy peace, Satan. The Son of Man needeth not, though thou givest it thy testimony. Hold thy peace and come out of the man.
At this word the man uttered a fearful cry of despair and rage, and foaming at the mouth cast himself, or rather was thrown down by the devil within him to the ground, where after a moment's terrific struggle with contortions of bodily anguish, he lay senseless as if dead. Jesus took him by the hand, and he stood up, and looking in the face of the prophet with earnestness and wonder, burst into tears of gratitude, exclaiming,
I am escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken, and I am escaped. God hath delivered me out of the hand of my enemy.
He then sat at the feet of Jesus, calm, grateful, happy, and in his right mind. All gazed on him with wonder, while from the great mass of the people rose a great shout, for they were all amazed, saying,
This is none other than the Christ, the Son of David. This is the King of Israel.
While the loud shouts of Hosanna, 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 cheered by a thousand voices,
Hosanna to our King,
shook like a passing storm the synagogue. When the noise had a little subsided, some of the scribes and Pharisees said, reproving him for not rebuking these cries,
Who is this that suffereth himself to be hailed as king? This is treason to the emperor.
Jesus then said in a loud, clear voice,
My kingdom is not of this world. I seek not an earthly throne or earthly scepter. My kingdom is from above. Ye say truly I am king.
He added with indescribable majesty,
And hereafter ye shall behold me sitting upon the throne of heaven.
When he had thus far spoken, he could not proceed farther, on account of the sudden and immense uproar which his words produced. Some shouted, Hosanna! Others said he blasphemed. One cried for the Roman guard, another for the priests to eject him from the tribune. Many rushed towards him to cast themselves at his feet, while many, putting their fingers in their ears, hurried forth from the synagogue, crying,
His blasphemies will cause the house to fall upon us and crush us!
Never was such an uproar heard. In the midst of it, Jesus conveyed himself away, none knew whither. And when I returned to the house of Martha, I heard his low, earnest, touching voice in prayer to God in his little chamber. He had sought its sacred quiet to be alone with his Father in heaven. At times I could hear him praying and supplicating in tones of the most heartbreaking pathos. At others, the silence of his room was only broken at intervals by sighs and pitiful groans that seemed to come from a breaking and crushed heart. Oh, what hand may remove the veil and reveal what passed there in that holy retirement between the prophet and his God? It was late in the day when he came forth, Martha having softly tapped at his door to say that the evening meal was prepared and alone waited for him. When he appeared, his face was colorless and bore traces of weeping. And though he smiled kindly upon us all, as he was wont to do, there was a deep-seated sorrow upon his countenance that brought tears to my eyes. Amelius joined us at the table, and with dear Lazarus and with Uncle Amos, we passed a sacred hour. For the prophet ate not, but talked to us much and sweetly of the love of God, and as all listened, the viands were forgotten. Pardon me, dearest father, if I am too warm and urgent in my efforts to bring you to accept Jesus as the Christ. Convinced as I am that he is Messiah, I cannot but ardently desire that you also should come to the knowledge of this truth. What he is yet to be, how he is yet to develop his majesty and power, is unknown to us all. Some do think that he will enter Jerusalem ere long, attended by tens of thousands of his followers, and that before him Pilate will peaceably vacate his procuratorial chair and retire, not only from the holy city but from Judea with his legions, that Jesus will ascend the throne of David and the glory of the age of Solomon be revived under his rule. Such, dear father, is the future of the prophet as looked for by all his disciples save one, and this is John, the husband of my cousin Mary. John, on hearing our views of the coming glory of the prophet, looks compassionate and says, "His kingdom is not of this world. He has naught to do with the splendors of earth. His glory you will behold, but it is the glory of the Spirit. Ere perceiving it fully, we may first pass through the valley of darkness, the gate of the tomb. He has distinctly said to me, 'I must first suffer many things at the hands of men before I enter upon my reign of glory. The Jews will seek me to kill me, and I shall be taken from among you. But let not sorrow fill your hearts. Death can have no power over me save such as I permit it to hold. I lay down my life, and I take it again. Through much tribulation and sorrow must the Son of God win the scepter of this earth, the hearts of men. I shall conquer, but to do so I must fall. Yet fear not, my death shall be the gateway to paradise for you all.'" Thus, dear father, do we discourse together about this wonderful prophet, whose future life is all a mystery, save that from the prophecies, we know it is to be inconceivably glorious, from his own lips, to be inconceivably sorrowful. But whether on a throne, giving laws to the world, or in the dust, borne down by the deepest woe, I shall still love, honor, reverence him, and trust in him as my Savior, my Prince, and the Holy One of God. Your devoted and loving, Adina.